The Ten Commandments. Life application of the Ten Commandments, with additional chapters on sin, salvation, prayer, and more. Updated edition. Written by Thomas Watson. Narrated by Saethon Williams. Obedience. Be silent and listen, O Israel. This day you have become a people for the Lord your God. You shall therefore obey the Lord your God, and do his commandments and his statutes, which I command you today. Deuteronomy 27:9-10. What is the duty that God requires of man? Obedience to his revealed will. It is not enough to hear God's voice, but we must obey. Obedience is part of the honor we owe to God. Then, if I am a father, where is my honor? Malachi 1:6. Obedience carries in it the lifeblood of religion. Obey the Lord your God by keeping all these commands and laws that I am giving you today. Obedience without knowledge is blind, and knowledge without obedience is lame. Rachel was fair to look upon, but being barren, said, "Give me children, or else I die." Genesis 30:1. Just so, if knowledge does not bring forth the child of obedience, it will die. To obey is better than sacrifice. 1 Samuel 15:22. Saul thought it was enough for him to offer sacrifices, even though he disobeyed God's command. But to obey is better than sacrifice. God refuses to accept sacrifice if obedience is lacking. I did not speak to your fathers, or command them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings and sacrifices. But this is what I commanded them, saying, "Obey my voice." Jeremiah 7:22-23. This doesn't mean that God prohibited these sacrifices and offerings, but the meaning is that he looked primarily for obedience. Without obedience, sacrifice was mere devout foolishness. The purpose as to why God has given us his laws is for us to learn obedience. God says, "You are to perform my judgments and keep my statutes to live in accord with them. I am the Lord your God." Leviticus 18:4. Why does a king publish an edict unless he expects it to be observed? What is the rule of obedience? The written word of God. Proper obedience is that which the word requires. Our obedience must correspond with the word, just as a copy must correspond with the original. To seem to be zealous, if it is not according to the word, is not obedience, but is only worship of the will. Roman Catholic traditions that have no footing in the word are abominable, and God will ask, "Who has required this at your hand?" Isaiah 1:12. The Apostle Paul condemns the worshipping of angels, which had a show of humility. Let no one keep defrauding you of your prize by delighting in self-abasement and the worship of the angels, taking his stand on visions he has seen, inflated without cause by his fleshly mind. Colossians 2:18. The Jews might say they were reluctant to be so bold as to go to God themselves, but they would be more humble and would prostrate themselves before the angels and desire them to present their petitions to God. But this show of humility was hateful to God, and there is no scripture to justify it. What are the aspects of our obedience that make it acceptable to God? It must be free and cheerful. It must be voluntary and not forced. If you consent and obey, you will eat the best of the land. Isaiah 1:19. Even though we serve God with weakness, it must be with willingness. You love to see your employees go cheerfully about their work. Under the law, God wants a free will offering. You shall celebrate the Feast of Weeks to the Lord your God with a tribute of a free will offering of your hand, which you shall give just as the Lord your God blesses you. Deuteronomy 16:10. Hypocrites obey God grudgingly and against their will. They do good, but not willingly. Cain brought his sacrifice, but not his heart. It is a true rule that what the heart does not do is not really done. Willingness is the soul of obedience. God sometimes accepts the willingness without the work, but he never accepts the work without the willingness. Cheerfulness shows that there is love in the duty. Love is to our duties what the sun is to fruit. It mellows and ripens them and gives them a better flavor. Obedience must be devout and fervent. Fervent in spirit. Romans 12:11. As water that boils over, so the heart must boil over with hot affections in the service of God. The glorious angels, who, because they are burning in fervor and devotion, are called seraphim, have been chosen by God to serve him in heaven. Under the law, the snail was unclean because it is a dull, slothful creature. Obedience without fervency is like a sacrifice without fire. Why should our obedience not be lively and fervent? God deserves the flower and strength of our affections. The Roman Emperor Domitian did not want his statue to be carved in wood or iron, but he wanted it to be made of gold. Enthusiastic affections make our duties as of gold. It is fervency that makes obedience acceptable. Elijah was fervent in spirit, and his prayer opened and shut heaven. He prayed again, and fire fell on his enemies. 2 Kings 1:10. Elijah's prayer brought down fire from heaven because, being fervent, it carried fire up to heaven. Obedience must be extensive. It must reach to all God's commands. Then I shall not be ashamed when I look upon all your commandments. Psalm 119:6. All God's requirements demand equal effort. There is a stamp of divine authority upon all God's commands. If I obey one precept because God commands, I must obey them all. True obedience runs through all duties of the Christian religion, just as the blood runs through all the veins. A good Christian makes gospel piety and moral equity unite. Some people discover their hypocrisy in this. They will obey God in some things that are easier, and they may raise their reputation, but they will leave other things undone. One thing you lack. Mark 10:21. Herod would hear John the Baptist, but would not leave his incest. Some will pray, but not give to others. Other people will give to others, but will not pray. You tithe mint and dill and cumin, and have neglected the weightier provisions of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. Matthew 23:23. The badger has one foot shorter than the other, and these hypocrites are shorter in some duties than in others. God does not like such partial servants, who will do some part of the work he wants them to do, but will leave other parts undone. Obedience must be sincere. We must aim at the glory of God in it. In the Christian religion, the purpose is everything. The purpose of our obedience must not be to stop the mouth of conscience or to gain applause or success, but our purpose must be to grow more like God and bring more glory to Him. Do all to the glory of God. 1 Corinthians 10:31. That which has diminished many glorious actions and made them lose their reward is that people's...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.